11.
Pastels everywhere!
Yeah, you know, the color palette in this special is oddly pale in comparison to the others, isn't it?
This is Yo! Son Goku and His Friends Return, an OVA released at Jump Super Anime Tour in 2008 in honor of Weekly Shonen Jump's 40th anniversary. If you've ever heard of this before, it's most likely because this special introduces a brand new character.
Vegeta's brother, Tabo. Because... vegetable. Vegeta. Tabo. Yay!
This special isn't especially good because of its story or its animation, but because it's one of the few entries on this list that feels distinctly Toriyama, top to bottom. Everyone feels in character, the art is incredibly charming, the action scenes are vibrant and full of wonderful motion, and despite the weird pull of Vegeta having a younger brother, it's oddly in line with Toriyama's eclectic writing style.
Also, we dare you to find a better villain name than Avocado.
Its biggest strength is, funny enough, its biggest weakness. It's fan service, top to bottom. It brings us back to these wonderful characters after over a decade of no new Dragon Ball animation, but that's kind of all there is to it. The villains are throwaway and the story is complete fluff.
But it's really all about the character interactions here and seeing our classic friends in new, modern animation. Unfortunately, its releases were pretty stifled and it never got a proper US release. But it's honestly pretty easy to find online if you search for it.
Which we highly recommend you do if you haven't seen it yet. It's charming, adorable, fun, and exactly what we'd love to see more of from the franchise. Now, if you don't mind, I've got me some onions to farm.
10.
Woohoo! Top 10, bitches! Oh, come on, Kaiser. Just because it has Goku in his GT outfit, the music sucks, and the plot is just a retelling of the Red Ribbon and Pilaf arcs doesn't make it any less beautifully animated and engaging.
I'm sorry, but I just feel like this movie has a ton of money dumped into a lazy idea. I mean, sure, they got Bulma's hair right for once. The animation is absolutely stunning, nearly on the level of the best of the modern material, if not better in some regards. The stuff with Ader is legit adorbs, and it packs a ton into its running time. It still feels poorly paced, oddly fragmented, and it has Dan Dan as the ending song, not Romantic Agenuyo!
While all those critiques you made are valid, you can't ignore how well some of those classic scenes are retold in this movie. With such scale and beauty that really makes you wonder why this movie wasn't more heavily pushed in the US, or Japan for that matter.
Honestly, it earns a place by making Yamcha look legitimately intimidating. I mean, for about 30 seconds, until he returns to himself. But those are a groundbreaking 30 seconds, plus this shot.
Okay, that power-up is pretty spectacular. Also, it's the only animated interpretation that stays true to the manga. Bulma never hits him with the car.
But she still shoots him, right?
Oh yeah, Bulma's straight cold-blooded. Fine, it could be in the top 10, by virtue of beauty and it being a Dragon Ball film. Even though, goddamn, Don Don Kokoro Hikari f***ing Deku!
9.
Quick, find us a Jaeger!
Eren Jaeger?
No, the Pacific Rim Jaeger. We've got a kaiju on the loose.
You know, I don't think any of us ever wanted kaiju in our Dragon Ball. But here Wrath of Dragon is, providing us with one of the scariest, most terrifying monsters in the entire franchise in the form of Herudegard.
It also gives us one of the more unique and interesting original characters Toei Animation ever created, Tapion. He's like a mixture of Link and Chrono, complete with a bitchin' mohawk and a tragic past. Oh, and Trunks' sword, which... Yeah, not even gonna try to explain why that doesn't make a lick of sense.
His tragedy spans worlds, as an ancient evil has been sealed away in both his and his younger brother Minosha's bodies. Tapion's being further locked away in a magic music box. Through the machinations of this little gremlin named Hoi, he is set free, and so is all hell. But not before we get some fascinating interactions between Tapion and Trunks that are very unique to this film, and offer a much more character-driven story than any of the previous movies on this list, and maybe on the entire list in general. It's also beautifully animated top to bottom, featuring some of the most on-model animation in the franchise and beautiful fight scenes.
Unfortunately, without spoiling too much, the ending really does kind of drop the ball in terms of how they defeat the villain, and while the monster certainly looks unique and terrifying, there's not much to it.
It's a beautiful movie with a terrifying, though shallow, villain, a fascinating original protagonist, sincere character moments, and some thrilling action. However, its pacing problems, unnecessary padding, and a highly questionable ending drag it lower on the list. Still, a must-see for Dragon Ball fans.
8.
Wait, is this BoJack?
I have good reasons. I swear I have good reasons.
All right, but if we don't agree, I am flipping this with Lord Slug, so help me.
Okay. Look, this movie is all about BoJack, the leader of the Galaxy Soldiers, a group of space gingers who are also pirates. Apparently, they were set free when King Gaia's planet went up in smoke. During the middle of a tournament held by some rich jackoffs, they decide to attack Earth and wipe out any possible obstacles on their way to intergalactic domination.
And don't tell me, Goku and the gang must stop them?
No, actually. Goku's dead. Like, dead, and has barely any involvement in this movie besides being an otherworldly spectator. I mean, okay, there's one scene where he gets involved, and Lord, is that infuriating in its own right. But besides that, no Goku.
I do have to admit, it's particularly nice to see the focus on so many characters that, in movies prior, were mostly put on the sidelines.
The tournament setup even allows for an unlikely battle between Trunks and Tenshinhan that is a total treat, utilizing all the best elements of Z.
It also has beautiful, imaginative scenery, even though it does devolve a bit into a murky, deserted cityscape near the end. And Gohan's power-up sequence against Bojack's goons is downright breathtaking.
Too bad the villains are about as interesting as a stack of teal and orange bricks. But you know, par for the course at this point, am I right?
Hey, Zangief's still hot.
Yeah, so is Beedo. Oh, what? When he says it, it's fine, but when I say it, it's weird?
7.
You know, I'm not sure how people are gonna feel about the placement on this list.
I think it's exactly where it needs to be. In the top 10, but not the top 5.
This movie is considered a sequel to the 2013 film Battle of Gods, and is all about the return of the franchise's greatest villain, Frieza. Remnants of his army have gathered the Dragon Balls and returned their tyrannical ruler back to lead their scattered forces. But all that's on old Freezy's mind is revenge.
Now, we should preface this immediately. One of the reasons this is so high on this list is that it feels like an actual full-length Dragon Ball film with a full coherent story structure, character and plot development relevant to the series, and a beautiful animation in most spots.
However, the truth is, this is a noticeably flawed production. While the first half of the movie is absolutely wonderful, showing a shades of development for the characters from their previous outing, introducing Jacko into the main story, and giving us some great character interactions that all feel both classic Dragon Ball and uniquely contemporary.
The second half of this film is stifled by an utter lack of tension as new forms are presented with great fanfare, but little actual meat. It's made worse when we find out just how little Frieza's upgrade means.
Also, Blooper Saiyan, aka Super Saiyan God, Super Saiyan God, Super Saiyan God, Super Saiyan God.
It's still an enjoyable film, even with its massive flaws. Though I am in it, so I suppose there's a wee bit of bias there. But we can truly, honestly put this in the top 10 just because of how utterly entertaining it is regardless.
The fight against the soldiers is one of the best action sequences the series has ever produced, and it should be noted that this is by far one of the funniest movies in the franchise as well. If you ever want to see a more in-depth review of this movie from us, check our YouTube channel.
Super Saiyan God Blue. So, quick question, is it stronger than Super Saiyan 4?
6.
I never understood why this movie was called Fusion Reborn. Everyone was still doing it at this time in the series.
Semantics aside, this movie is pretty spectacular. In a hilarious series of events involving the Otherworld's soul cleansing machine, all the denizens of Hell have been let loose. But more terrifying is the evil known as Janemba, the culmination of all siphoned evil from Hell.
So you're telling me that the villain is a big, fat, jolly creature that turns into an even more menacing pinkish creature of pure evil?
Yeah, Taka. All of the movies rip off the show. Well, almost all of them anyway.
Honestly, while Janemba is a shameless ripoff of Boo, he's also particularly entertaining in his own right. Even in his giant baby-like form, his capacity for destruction is enormous. Not to mention, the way that Otherworld distorts is uniquely strange and bizarre, offering up some incredibly quirky visuals.
Both before and after he transforms into his true form, he showcases some spectacular abilities, such as summoning his own demonic sword, creating dimensional portals, and deconstructing himself at will.
Why do I get the sudden urge to play with Legos?
And on Earth, we get to see the consequences of Hell opening up as some brief cameos are made by classic villains, like Frieza.
And Hitler!
And of course, this is the only appearance of Gogeta in the entire series outside the games.
Well, you mean before Super Saiyan 4 goes?
Lenny, I swear to God, I'll burn your apartment down.
If it weren't for the fact that the final battle is disappointingly short, Janemba is devoid of any actual character, and the movie spends a little too much time dragging its feet until the climax, this might be higher on the list.
But it certainly earns its spot in the top 10 by being funny, full of fantastic action, and offering some unique visuals, concepts, and the instrument of a million fanfictions, Gogeta.
I wonder if we'll get Gogeta in Dragon Ball Super. Super Saiyan God, Super Saiyan Gogeta, Super God, Blue, Super Blue God.
Yeah.
5.
I'm glad Pilaf made it into one of these original movies.
I don't know, he's more like a ripoff of Piccolo Jr. if you ask me. Son of a would-be guardian of Earth out for revenge, mixed with a little bit of Raditz, what with him kidnapping Gohan and all.
Can we just take a moment to acknowledge that his name is just flat-out Garlic Jr.? And when we were kids, we didn't even bat an eye?
Probably because this movie is just so damn good. It features some of the best animation of its time for the franchise, a villain with actual motivation steeped in the series lore, a set of minions that are quirky and threatening,
and we even get to see Kami get in on the action. Although, the plot hole of Garlic Jr. trying to kill Piccolo before using the Dragon Balls is kind of severe. Kind of a huge logistical oversight.
Plot hole aside, you can definitely feel some of the classic Dragon Ball aesthetic in the art and the music bleed through. This being the first Z movie definitely accounts for that, and you get some incredibly choreographed fight scenes here.
Dead Zone isn't all about the muscles, the violence, and the power levels. It's about rescue, revenge,
and Gohan peeing in Krillin's mouth.
Thus starting the long line of Krillin being treated like garbage in the movies. Anyone ever notice that? They basically made a running gag out of how useless he is in these films.
The defeat of the villain is also relatively original in regards to the series.
Although the amount of hubris on display here is astonishing even for this franchise.
Regardless, Dead Zone definitely earns its spot at number 5. Now if you'll excuse me, I'm gonna have myself an apple.